Well, hello everyone. Welcome to enjoythemusic.tv and enjoythemusic.com live stream of CES 2017. We are here with, boom, Alan Sircom of Hi-Fi Plus magazine. Let me bring him right in. Hey Alan, how you doing?
Hi there, I'm good, thank you. How are you? Tough question.
Live streaming is not as easy as it looks.
Nope, it never is. It never is. Unfortunately, as ever, the connections here, despite this being the city of technology today, the connections are usually dreadful, and I reserve the right to drop out at any moment. But in the meantime, things are good.
Well, you are looking good. Wink, wink.
Thank you very much. Feeling very good. Thank you very much.
Now, why don't you tell us first a little bit about Hi-Fi Plus magazine before we roll into what you saw during CES.
Sure. Hi-Fi Plus magazine is an international, based out of England, international high-end magazine covering the best of high-end, both in terms of traditional audio and now more into headphones and the streaming event, everything except loud air conditioning units,
which we hear in the background.
Yeah,
so sorry
absolutely.
To all those who are watching.
Apologize.
But why don't you tell us, okay, you've been trudging through the halls, getting taxis or God only knows what. Why don't you tell
absolutely.
Us what you've seen at the show?
Okay. Well, CES 2017 is, it's not disappointing, but neither is it exactly appointing. I think that the this year, numbers are down. It's quieter than we've seen in a long time. There are fewer manufacturers here, but those who are here, it's quality versus quantity. And I think we're seeing some very, very good stuff, especially some very good stuff at the top end in terms of loudspeakers, mm-hmm. but also a number of devices. Unfortunately, we haven't had time to upload photographs because I've literally just jumped out of the show. So I'm going to have to talk you through things. But one of the stars of the show, I think, is the YG Acoustics Sonya XV. This is a large four-box version of the existing Sonya.
Yes.
Which is a wonderful loudspeaker. This is a wonderful loudspeaker that's upgradable from the existing Sonya to add extra bass units. The second set of towers are purely bass towers, and it involves some degree of surgery on your loudspeakers, but nothing too radical. The YG has very much a continuous improvement and upgrade path. So it's not a loudspeaker. You start with a Sonya, you can move right the way up. And this is truly, it's an awesome speaker. It needs awesome power, and it needs a lot. Well, actually, awesome room size, I think, is the big thing. It's on the top floor of the Venetian, which is always these huge barns of rooms.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a glorious sounding loudspeaker. We were listening to it through AudioNet Electronics, and yeah, it was singing like a good one. It's also, it manages to scale, which, given a loudspeaker that's 6 foot plus tall, and two, and there are four of them in the room.
And they weigh probably a ton or two.
They weigh a lot because they're every single part of it's aluminum, even down to the drive units. They mill down the drive units from a 30-pound billet of aluminum down to an 8-ounce drive unit, which is an impressive way of doing things. And they look awesome. They look very black, so they're very difficult to photograph. It's a black thing in a black room that's black. So whenever you try and photograph them, all you just see is a black image. So there wouldn't have been much to show up anyway. So we could put up a screen of nothingness, and that would work.
Well, it's funny because I'm on their website showing the 15th anniversary Extreme version, mm-hmm. and it's black on
yep.
black on black.
Yep, absolutely. They seem to like none more black. There's a pair of loudspeakers that they've made in non-black, which are in this kind of rich, dark red, which is wine red, which I've seen, and they look wonderful, but I don't think they're going to do it again, and they'll probably hate me for saying it. But, they're in on display in a store called Audio Lounge in London. But, yeah, they're very good. And, obviously these are several hundred thousand dollars, and they need a good system to work with, and they need a good room, but when they work, they sing. Staying at the expensive end, obviously this fits with our magazine structure. There's I recently heard, just now, I heard a wonderful system, not in the show itself, over the road in the Mirage Hotel, which is based around Nagra electronics and Wilson Audio Alexes, which are $103,000 replacement to the Max. And they sound insanely good.
Oh,
and
this
is one of those things where everyone is saying, who's been there has said, this is a sensational room. I mean, obviously, it's a lovely room. The system's lovely, but it just breathes, just sings. We were listening to things, but you just don't believe this happens. I was lucky enough to recently to go to Utah to hear the new Whams, which are astonishing. And at $685,000, you'd expect them to be astonishing. Mm-hmm. But what's really fascinating is just, in a way, how much of that DNA has filtered down to speakers like the Alex. And this is, we're actually in a great time. This year, 2016, I was fortunate to get to see the factory at Wilson, YG, and Magico in the same year. And we've got three of the best companies there, and Magico are also launching the S3 Mark II at the show, and they have the M3 on display in another room. And the S3 Mark II, which is a $28,000 loudspeaker, I've heard it in sort of prototype form, and it sounds wonderful. And we are at this point, this amazing point, where, yes, these are very expensive loudspeakers, and they're very good loudspeakers, but we're at a point where this couldn't have been done 5 years ago. You listen to them, what we're getting in terms of detail, resolution, and dynamics, and fluidity, and hanging together, and the whole thing is something that we just could not have done 5 years ago. Absolutely not.
And which Magico model was this?
Well, they're showing the S3 Mark II as a prototype, but also they're demonstrating the M3 in the Constellation Room, and that's also sounding good. And staying with that, in the Constellation Room, they have an entirely new range, which is called Resolution, I believe. Now, this is a range of preamplifier, line preamplifier, phono stage, and power amplifier, both stereo and mono power amplifier, which I'm just calling up my knowledge about bass about it. Yeah, the Revelation series. It's the Pictor preamplifier, Andromeda phono stage, and Taurus power amplifiers. Now, these are basically they're the performance of the performance series, but with the look of the Inspiration series. And the price is somewhere between the two. So we're looking at $18,000 per preamp for the preamp, the phono stage, and I think $19,500 for the power amplifier. They were only on display. They weren't being played. But what they were also playing there that was new was the Centaur 2 500, which is a 500 watt foot stereo version of the existing Centaur 2, which is a $55,000 power amplifier. Now, it's an exceptional piece of equipment in 250 watt form. It's an exceptional piece of equipment in 500 watt monoblock form. But they worked out that some people, unfortunately, can't keep a 500 watt pair of monoblocks for domestic reasons. So a 500-watt stereo amp is going to be great for those people who need it. And, yeah, it sounded wonderful with the M3s just a singing sweetly.
And the brand again was Constellation Audio?
That's Constellation Audio, yes. So
just making sure I'm giving people the beauty shot right now.
Yep, the Constellation Audio Revelation series, which looks functionally similar to the Inspiration line. But as I said, it's got the performance of the performance. So you're getting a $28,000-$30,000 phono stage, and this is the Andromeda is there currently there. I don't want to say entry level because $18,000 for an entry level phono stage is still spendy.
Yes.
But this is their starter phono stage. They can't build one into the Inspiration line without sacrificing performance, they feel. So this is a sensational sounding system. The Constellation is generally a sensational sounding system, even the Inspiration line. And if this is something where you're getting that performance sound for about a third less. And I think that gives a good offer. So that's good. Obviously, we have now spent a lot of time talking about some extraordinarily expensive pieces of equipment. Not everything is expensive, especially the air conditioning in this unit, which is cheap as a chip because it's breaking all the time, I think. But yeah, one of the other products that we've seen is the Cord Mojo Poly.
Yes.
Sorry, the Cord Poly. Now, the Poly is an add-on unit to the Mojo. The Mojo is a small, portable, battery-operated DAC, battery-powered DAC, which sounds sensational. And it's, I know the price. I think it's $500, but I can't remember.
I can tell people in just a second. I'm actually pulling it up. So it looks like it's going for, okay, for some reason I don't have the price, but that sounds about right.
Yeah, I think $499 is the figure. Certainly, I know it in the UK. I think it's a similar price.
Yes, $499 British pounds.
Yep,
just so that everybody understands, we're talking the... Oh, I don't want to talk about the British pound itself. You don't want to go there, do you?
No, definitely not. It's so bad at the moment that I'm living on poverty spec. But anyway, but this Cord Mojo was a fantastic DAC, and it was launched about a year ago, a year and a bit ago, and it's been a wonderful device for things. But one of the things that obviously has happened since then is the iPhone 7's been about, and that the days of the headphone socket and the digital output perhaps are numbered. So what they, Cord, have done in their infinite wisdom, seemingly, is to add a thing called the Poly, which plugs into the side of the Mojo, is charged, it has its own little battery, and it's charged. It charges the Mojo as you use it as well. And this is it's a wireless streaming device. You can use, if you want, a micro SD card, but you can also, you can stream practically everything. You can stream off a phone, you can stream off a network system. It's completely wireless. It's Bluetooth. It'll deal with everything. AirPlay, you name it, it works with it. It's fully Rune ready. It's just integrates with everything.
It does everything. It's been an incredible product for them.
Yeah, and this Poly transforms the Mojo into a truly portable DAC, high resolution DAC device. And we've worked out that the break between the headphones and the source device is now fully wireless, even if the wire from the headphone still exists. So this is a sensational piece of equipment, and I think this would be something. And it's a $500 add-on to a $500 DAC. So
the other thing is it's battery powered, so which is great clean sound. So for $1,000, you basically get something that can handle from Rune to everything. That's a good price point.
But one of the things, it's got so much processing power on it, processing power, that I tried it there and streamed some material off an iPad, and it connected to it so fast. And it really was just insanely quick. And this is because it's got so much processing. There's no lag, there's no lead time, there's no anything. It just works. And it works with practically everything. They've designed it just to be... an idiot-proof DAC. Yeah, okay, so journalists are remarkable.
Who are you calling an idiot besides me, which is not far from the truth, but...
better idiot as well. So it's all good. But I think, I mean, certainly there's a degree of the portable audio which is becoming, it's really blooming.
Yes.
The difficulty, I think, here with the show is that although we've covered all the areas in the Venetian Tower, a lot of this is now moved into the convention center, or the zoo, as we like to call it.
Oh, and it is a zoo. I mean, for those curious who are watching, imagine, 10, 20 football fields just jam-packed with endless... I think somebody did a calculation years ago. If you wanted to visit every booth just in the LVCC, you'd have a grand total of 7 or 10 seconds at each booth if you wanted to cover all of them.
Yep, absolutely. And I think it's even more than that. And added to the fact there are 170,000 people milling around in an exhibition center.
Oh, so
it's a rolling sea of people, and it's crazy.
It is.
But yeah, so they've moved the high resolution sensor and the sort of headphone section to there. So that means that I haven't been there yet. So I've spoken to colleagues who have, and they said it's fantastic. And there's a lot of really interesting new stuff from companies like MyTech. And there's been lots of talk about Tidal integrating better with Meridian's MQ, or with MQA.
Right. They just announced the MQA. Yeah. And we also published the MyTech, which have this cute little cigarette. You haven't seen it yet, then? It's this cute little cigarette-looking thing.
Yeah, I've heard some wonders about it, and I think it's going to be sensational. But yeah, what has happened with it's meant that the specialty audio section in the Venetian has become very specialty. So it is walking into places and everything's umpty thousand. Strangely enough, Burmester, who's not afraid of spending, not afraid of very high prices, launched at the show, they launched their new B18 stand mount, which is a variant on their popular B10. Mm. This is a B18 floor stander, which is a 2.5-way version of the B10 monitor that the late Dieter Burmester wanted for his own studio.
Yes.
It's great having basically your own audio company. if you want to make your own studio, you say, I need some speakers. Guys, build me some speakers. And they did, and they're great. They're really good little speakers. They don't use the ribbon tweeter. They use instead a titanium ring radiator dome and carbon fiber drive units. They've added a new, it's a 2.5-way with an extra bass unit. And it looks fantastic. It really does look. It looks the part. It's very rich, gloss, walnut with the usual sort of metal sheen. It looks fantastic. It sounds very good. It's remarkably potent sounding little speaker for 7K, which is, that's sorry, 7,000 euros. Got to make that clear. We don't know the US price or the UK prices yet. But at 7,000 or 8,000 euros a pair, they're going to go very well. And Burmester, as traditionally, we've shied away. We've always thought the electronics were great and the loudspeakers were loudspeakers. But in the mm-hmm. recent years, I think Burmester has started to make some really, really good loudspeakers. And, I mean, there is a whole host of people I haven't had a chance to see yet who I think will be delivering some good things. I know there's some new stuff from ELAC. I know there's new stuff from a number of brands that I've seen. But I think it's a fascinating time of excitement in a way. I mean, it's difficult. The only difference is that nobody's showing up at the show. It does seem. I think that's an audio thing.
Well, I think what's happening is, as you said, like the headphones and all that have moved to the circus or bullpen. You're right. You have these ultra high end ones that are staying in the Venetian. But on another level, I believe you have to agree in some ways that high-end audio products have now come down to earth, and there's a lot of stuff under, say, 2,000 or even 1,000 that's incredible.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I was thinking, and I'm going to go back to that Cord merger thing, because I've been using one for a while. But in addition, also, Cord have also launched a new version of the Hugo. And they've also launched I think it's a Bluetooth CD transport, which I'm quite surprised, but it works, it's a good CD transport. But I think one of the big things, I keep going back to the Mojo, because, I've used that. I've spent a lot of time in the air recently going to various different shows and all around the world. And I've spent a lot of time,
I remember your post on Facebook, and I pointed you to this robot that I kind of...
Yeah, I think I've been out of the country 14 times in 12 months and each time for a week. And then you still have a magazine to run, and by which time you're twitching. But I mean, I can't complain, because obviously, you've got some great audio. You listen to, you spend some, but
and
it does
food.
Seem to be difficult. And great food.
Come on.
You don't get to look like this if you don't, unless you
look
like...
Oh, no, that's nothing.
Like great food.
I love the traveling. I kind of miss the Italy show, but the problem is... I would gain a kilo at least like a week.
Yeah, easily.
Easily.
Yeah. It was such a great show. But, when you're in the air, obviously you spend a lot of time. You're listening to music, and you're listening to you're watching videos or whatever, and you're going to do that, you listen with a good pair of headphones or a good, to try and drown out the sound of the place. You're listening in the evening, maybe you've done your bit and you want to just relax and
just
maybe
tune out. That's why I love these in-ears.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I was going to say, that I've got a pair of decent in-ear monitors and a couple of and a good Cord Mojo, and you sit there and think, this is insanely good for
money that
we would have hitherto spent on an interconnect cable. Yeah. And yes, people are still making great interconnects. So Crystal just launched a extreme Crystal and Siltec between them both launched new power cords, which are wonderful. This is Crystal's one is an upgrade on the absolute dream. I think they're running out of dreams to have now. This is the ultimate dream. And Siltec have taken their triple crown stuff and added it to a power cord. And these are fantastic things. And also in the same vein, Nordos just launched a USB
two cable.
Valhalla 2 USB, which should be wonderful. And hopefully I'll get that soon. But those things are fine. They're not going away. But the fascinating part is that you can get so much good audio from a tiny little box that's the size of a pack of Lucky Strikes, and don't smoke. But if you do,
too late. I already do. Except I do cigars.
Yeah, but this thing is just the size of a pack of Lucky Strikes and a pair of earphones that fit in a box like that.
And you get fantastic sound.
That's fantastic sound. And that wasn't just an ad for Western, but they are great, great monitors.
It's all good.
Yeah. Anyway.
Let's wrap this up. Anything else? No. Last comments?
No, I think I've seen... there was one thing I did notice, staying with this high-resolution thing. I went into Kimber Cable's room. And Kimber are working remarkably closely with Sony, and they're releasing high-resolution, high-end cables for Sony's top headphone amps, for top headphones, and there it is. There's the beast.
I have one. I'm waiting on them to send me a cable to review it. Let me just do the beauty shot to me so people can see it. While I was the first to review the NWZX2, yes, I actually do. Here's proof. I do have the latest model. I'm just waiting on the 4.4 millimeter balanced cable, which they're custom making me for my in-ear monitors, which are, and I'll give a shout out to Noble. I have their K10s with rose gold.
I love Noble audio K10s. I've got a set of Kaiser 10i CIM.
Aren't they? Come on.
Just the best thing. it's shockingly good. And this is the point. We're getting to this wonderful point where you stick these things in your ears and that's a $40,000 loudspeaker in your head.
I said that in a review, actually, and I got some hate email from a few people. It was like, I mean, first off, Nobles are great. And then I convinced them to make the first ones with rose gold, because anyone who knows me knows I'm a rose gold guy. That's all I wear in gold. And they did it. And the funny thing is, as soon as I did the review, I don't know how many orders they got, but he said it was just incredible.
And this stuff is incredible. And it's the quality, the performance is really off the hook. It's just it's just so good. But I mean, this is in a way getting away from the point. But this new I want to say there's a renaissance at Sony now. They're really taking audio seriously, much more so than anyone gives them credit for, because they think, hey guys, it's Sony. Forget the hey guys, it's Sony. They're not just a company that makes Walkmans. They're not just a company that makes PlayStations. They take this really seriously.
There is no doubt about it that not only are they taking this seriously, but they're really giving support for high res audio initiative. Mm-hmm.
Ray Kimber was saying part of the reason this whole Kimber connection came around is that they're scouting through high resolution audio files, looking for the best in DSD files, not just to play, not just to show off, but to say, because they're interested, because they're geeks about it, because they love it. And these guys found his ISOMic stuff and said, oh, you make cables. Oh, we measure your cables, and they're fantastic. And I think that's sensational. I'm terribly sorry. One of the things of jet lag is my ears. So I keep noticing it. I do apologize.
It's quite all right. Well, anyway. I think we've pretty much covered everything and successfully pretty much gone over time, which is perfect.
Fantastic. Sorry about that, lads. Anyway.
No, thank you so much, because I know time is so valuable during CES. We really, really do appreciate it.
No problems, not at all. Have a good time.
Thank you so much, Alan, and I will bring the camera back to me. That was Alan Sircom of Hi-Fi Plus magazine. It's a great magazine. You can go to their website, of course, just type in Hi-Fi Plus, and they're a partner with us. I guess I should simply bring it to me and tell everyone who I am, run my...